he has been there maybe 3 times less than the pilot. The man who has really been so mightily used by God. I want to just say 2 sentences about him. This is a man who sincerely has devoted his whole life just to proclaim the gospel to the dying world. Number 2, he's a man who loves young people, who's very passionate, who is full of commitment exclusively for the young people. So this morning, without wasting much time, we want to introduce this man who is truly sent from God, sent by God, who has been so mightily used, particularly with young people. So this morning, how many of you would like to join hands in welcoming this man of God? Will you raise your hand? Praise the Lord. Pastor Rand.
Thank you, my good pastor. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
That was weak. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
How are you?
Fine.
Nice to see you. Is there anyone among us who's not a Seventh-day Adventist? Can I see your hand? Oh, how nice. What's your name?
Shake my hand.
What does AJ mean?
Georgia Exactly.
All right, professor. Hi, how are you? Did you raise your hand?
Yes.
Oh, good. What's your name? Albert is a good name. Nice to have you. Who else is not a Seventh-day Adventist? Hi, how are you? What's your name? Who? Louise. Welcome, Louise. Who else? I saw another hand. Did I see someone else? You're not a Seventh-day Adventist. All right, we're delighted to have you. God bless you. God bless your studies. And hopefully very soon someone will say you are a Seventh-day Adventist. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
All right. What are you studying? Who's doing the counting? Okay, yes, good. Biology. All right, chemistry. History. Nursing. Dentistry. English. All right, engineering. Oh, okay. This class belongs to you. Let me thank God very much for the honor, the privilege, the blessing of having these few moments with you. Before I go any further, let's bow our heads. Well, before I go, please turn your phones off. Let me set the example by turning mine off. I observe students walking up and down the corridor, and their heads were down, and I know they weren't texting Jesus. So, mine is off. Please turn yours off. Are you doing that? Is that all? Okay, sister, God bless you for being obedient. The cell phones, anything that can make a noise. Let's bow our heads now and pray. Loving Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of life. We thank you that, God, we can come to you through Jesus Christ. And because Christ is on the right hand of the Father, when we come to you, that's where we come in Christ. Not even the angels can come that close. Father in heaven, put your words in my mouth, I pray, and grant the spirit of comprehension to your sons and daughters. Bless this institution, bless the students, bless the hard-working parents who support them in this place. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Question for you, what is the greatest event in the history of the universe? The greatest event in the history of the universe. What is that? Well, raise a hand and I'll ask you to tell me. That's how you raise your hand. Now, someone raise a hand, I give you an answer. What is the greatest event in the history of the universe? Yes, my brother.
Christ's sacrifice.
Well, the sacrifice, what's your name?
Vladimir.
Yes. Where are you from, Vladimir?
Germany.
Germany's a good place. I was there this year or last year. Frankfurt, Stuttgart, Berlin, nice place. The sacrifice of Jesus Christ, which means his coming, his sinless life, his death, his resurrection, that is the greatest event in the history of the universe. Now in John 5:39, Jesus says, search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life, and they are they which testify, finish the verse, of me. Did I turn something off? Christ, okay. Christ is saying, he is the center of the Bible. Let me say it again. Jesus Christ is the center of the Bible, not simply as the creator, but also as the savior, because his coming, his death, his sacrifice, as Vladimir so correctly stated, is the greatest event in the universe. Now, why did he come? Matthew 1:21, the angel told Mary in a dream, and she shall, told Joseph, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. Why? Finish the verse. For he shall save his people from their sins. Now, let's connect two things. The greatest event in the history of the universe is the coming of Christ to this earth to live, die, rise again. He did that to save people from sin, which means everything a person undertakes, I'm not being extreme, I'm being literal, everything a believer undertakes should be connected to this central event in the history of the universe, which is the sacrifice of Christ. Now, my question for you, how is your choice of study connected to the central purpose for which Christ came to this earth? How is your course of study of contribution to the mission that Christ came to carry out? And that's a question only you can answer. Let me put it more simply. Why did you come to AUP? Here's another opportunity to raise your hand. Why did you come to AUP? Was it connected to the sacrifice of Christ? I'll ask you differently. Were you thinking of God when you made the choice to come to AUP? Or if you're visiting from AIS or from wherever, what was the motivating factor? In 1 Corinthians 10, verse 31, I'm sure some of you know it, the Bible says, whether therefore ye eat, say it with me, or drink, go on, or whatsoever ye do, stop. What do you understand by whatsoever ye do? Everything, blessings upon you. Every single thing, of course, except sin. You can't glorify God by sin. The verse ends by saying, do all to the glory of God. When we think of symbolic language in the Bible, what book do we usually think of? Revelation. That verse we just read is not from Revelation. It is a literal verse. Whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, finish it for me, do all to the glory of God. Now, you chose to come to AUP. That comes under whatsoever ye do. I ask you again. Did you come for the conscious purpose of the glory of God? And I don't need an audible answer. It is for your personal reflection and your examination of your motive. The way heaven thinks is not the way earth thinks. When a person adopts a heavenly way of thinking, the person appears entirely out of place on the earth. Let me say it again. When you adopt a heavenly mindset and you apply it to everything you do, you become an alien on the earth. Because the earth's mindset and heaven's mindset is as vastly different as light is from darkness. And so 1 Corinthians 10:31 says, whatever you do, if you go to the restaurant tonight, when you pick up that menu, and you start to make your eating choices, you must think of the glory of God. as insignificant. Let me tell you a little something that happened to me. I flew to Loma Linda, California, Los Angeles, to speak somewhere in Southern California, Loma Linda area, I believe. And the local pastor picked me up. It was an Indonesian church. On the way from the airport to where I was staying, he said, "Are you hungry?" I said, "Well, I'm not dying, but I can eat something." So he and I went to a restaurant. And the lady brought us the, what do you call those things, the menus. So we looked, and we just chose, just naturally. When she came for our choices, she looked at our choices, and he and I did not collaborate. She said, "You must be vegetarian." And then she said, "I would love to be a vegetarian, yeah, but I can't." Now, I heard that as a cry for help. Mm. So I told the pastor, get counsels on diets and foods, have the entire church board sign it, bring it back and give it to that woman. She has just cried out for help. Now, why did she cry out for help? Because of the way we chose. Are you with me? Simple, insignificant. I was, last week, I was in Victoria Tarlac, and I was in my hotel lobby. I was carrying around my Bible with me, and this man just came to me. I'm just walking the Bible right here. I'm walking back and forth. I pace a lot when I have to speak. And I'm pacing back and forth. And he just walked up to me. He said, "Are you a preacher?" I said, "Yes." Then he said, "What church?" I said, "The Seventh-day Adventist Church." Now, why did he ask me that, those two questions? Because he saw me with a Bible. A simple, simple act of witness. Whether, therefore, ye eat or drink. There's a habit I began practicing about a few years ago. You may laugh, but I'll tell you, but don't laugh too loudly. I began praying to God about what I should wear when I go outside. You want to laugh? Go ahead. Take 5 seconds and laugh. All right, you finished? Good. I said, "Father, particularly when I'm flying to go somewhere, what should I wear? What suit? What shirt? What tie? What shoe?" Literally. Since I began doing that, you'll be amazed at what people have said to me. I was coming through South Africa this year, and there was a man ahead of me. We just came through customs, so we're going to the place to be picked up by our friends. So he heard me behind him, and he stepped back. And he said, "You go ahead of me, because you're preaching." Mm-hmm. So I just looked at him. How did he? But clearly he drew that conclusion from what? Come on, loudly. The way I was dressed. But I wasn't dressed in a fancy way. I just dressed according to the conviction God placed on my heart when I said, "What should I wear?" I was coming through South Africa again. And I went to the customs to check my passport. The man looked at me, he said, "Come, Pastor." I said, "Why do you say that?" He said, "But you look like one." I left him, I went to another officer who did not hear my interaction with this first man. He said, "Come, Bishop." I said, "Why do you say that?" He said, "It is so obvious, you're a preacher." I said, "Okay." I was leaving Nigeria last year. Coming to the airport. I entered the airport building, going to wherever I had to go to show my passport. I had to pass a counter where there was some man working. He said, "Come, Bishop, come." I said, "Why do you call me Bishop?" He said, "But you're a pastor." Then he took off his hat. He said, "Bless me." So I blessed him. Yes. I hit him and a blessing came on. And then I left. I was in South Africa again. I'm trying to tell you, when you try to do things for God's glory. I was going to speak at a university campus, University of Fitzwatersrand or something. I went to a little store to get some chewing gum. People from the U.S. love to chew gum. And I walked to the lady, I said, I went to buy some juice first, some juice. I said, "May I have some juice?" She said, "Yes." When she went to get the juice, she went to the liquor the place where the alcohol was. When she came back, I said, is that juice or alcohol? She said, I would never give you alcohol. I said, why? She said, you're a preacher. I said, why do you say that? She said, but you look like one. I left that store. There's another store right next door, because she did not sell a chewing gum. I walked up, he said, come, teacher. Now God is hearing me and telling the truth. I said, why do you call me that? He said, the anointing is all over you. Amen. Now this began to happen when I began to pray and say, God, what should I wear? I was coming back home to the United States, coming through customs, and the customs officer looked at me. You know, these men tend to be frowny and serious and harsh, and you know, they're so bored checking passports all day. He looked at me, he said, preacher or lawyer? I said, preacher. He said, oh, the opposite of lawyer. I said, preacher. I was on a plane. The plane landed, we all stood up to get out. This lady was standing next to me, she looked at me, preacher. I was sitting next to a young lady on another flight. Sat next to her. I don't talk to women on planes unless they talk to me first. Are you with me? They may think I'm making a prophetic pass. I don't want to. And so I sat quiet. I mean, when I get to the seat, I say hi, and that's it. She looked at me. She said, are you a preacher? I said, yes. I said, why do you say that? She said, you look like one. I was on another flight. Sat next to a lady. She said, are you a preacher? I said, yes. She said, I am so glad. I said, why? She said, in case of turbulence. I am sitting next to a preacher. My young friends, what am I trying to tell you? Everything you do. How many of you have boyfriends? Raise your hand. Raise your hand, sister. You have one. Raise your hand. Okay. How many of you have girlfriends? Raise your hand. You don't have a boyfriend? You have one. You don't have one? You have one? You don't have one? It's against the law in the Philippines? All right, that's fine. No rush, no rush. No rush. Do you have your eye on somebody? No, not yet. Tomorrow you will. Okay. When that decision comes to you, your first question must be, not does he have a job? Does he have a car? If I connect to this young man, where is the glory for God? Who's doing engineering? Raise your hand with pride, engineer. God is an engineer. Okay. Were you thinking of God when you chose it? No. You'll still be saved, don't panic. No. No, he wasn't. Not because he's bad. Because most believers have not developed the automatic behavior. How will God be glorified? My young friends, God wants to bless what you're doing. But God does not bless what is not for his glory. Are you with me? Now the devil can bless you. That's a serious consideration. Listen to Revelation 13 from verse 1. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns. And upon his horns, 10 crowns, and upon his head, the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet was the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. Now verse 2 ends this way. And the dragon, who can finish it? Gave him his power, his seat, and what? Great authority. Listen to what the Bible says. The dragon, who is the dragon? Revelation 12:9. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan. The dragon is Satan. The Bible says the dragon gave power, seat, authority to this beast power. We know who the beast power is. The devil can give you worldwide influence. What did he say to Jesus? All these kingdoms, all these things will I give you if you will fall down and worship me. Here's how the Bible describes the wicked in Job 21:7-15. The cow calveth and casteth not her calf. Her bull gendereth and faileth not. They send forth the little ones like a flock. Their children dance. They take the timbrel and harp and rejoice at the sound of the organ. They spend their days in wealth. That's how the wicked are described. Where did they get all of that? Not from God. The devil can bless you in quotation marks. So you need to know, is this from God or is this from the enemy? The devil can perform miracles. I mean genuine miracles, but he does it for deceptive reasons. And so the fact that you're flourishing might not mean that you have the blessing of God. Mm-hmm. The blessing of God is attached where the glory of God is your priority. Let me say it again. The blessing of God is attached where the glory of God is your priority. And so I urge you, my young friends, my young brothers and sisters, review why you're doing what you're doing. In Genesis chapter 4, reading from verse 1, the Bible says, "And Cain knew his wife, Eve his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain. And Adam knew his wife, she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. And she again bare his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. And in process of time it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. And Abel, he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof." Cain brought an offering, Abel brought an offering. Cain came to worship, Abel came to worship. Keep this in mind. "And the Lord had respect unto Abel and to his offering, but unto Cain and to his offering, he had not respect." Now, here's Cain, here's his offering, here's Abel, here's his offering. Why did God reject Cain's offering and accept Abel's offering? Verse 5 ends, "And Cain was very wroth." What is wroth?
Angry.
Angry. "And his countenance fell." Listen to verse 6 as God speaks. "And the Lord said unto Cain, why art thou wroth?" Now, your scholars, reason with me. The question why solicits an explanation. Why are you wroth? In other words, what is the reason for your anger? God isn't judging the anger first. He is trying to get behind the reason for the anger. This introduces a principle by which God functions. God's primary concern is not what you do. Notice I said primary, but what? Why you did it. Now, here's how Ellen White puts it. Christ Object Lessons, page 316, paragraph 2. "Every act is judged by the motive." Or the motives. "Every act is judged by the motives that prompt it." Child Guidance, page 201, paragraph 3. "Every course of action has a twofold character and importance. It is virtuous or vicious, right or wrong, according to the motive which prompts it." What am I saying? When God judges your choice of engineering, your choice of accounting, your choice of English, your choice of Tagalog, whatever you're studying, he looks behind what drove you to make that choice. That's where he looks first. And that's where motives exist. Even in secular settings, when an investigator is looking into a murder, what is he looking for first? A motive. Why did he kill his wife? The policeman stops you for speeding. He wants to know, in the United States, they may ask you, do you have a legal reason for speeding? What's your motive? What's your reason? Now, having said all of that, I come back to the question, my good-looking young friends. Why did you choose what you chose? Was the glory of God in your thinking? If you want to see where some young people put God's glory first, read Daniel chapter 1. Daniel 1. "Here are four young men, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. They had every reason to compromise. They have been conquered by a foreign army. They have been transplanted to a foreign country. They are under the command of the king to eat that, to study this. They're given different names. Pressure. And yet, when the circumstance required it, they risked their lives to protect the glory of God. Why did you choose what you chose? To be the best engineer? That's good. It's not the reason God wants. You must connect your choice to the glory of God. How will I use engineering for God's glory? How will I use nursing for God's glory? How will I use whatever you're doing? History for God's glory. Theology for God's glory. How? How? When that is the thing that drives your mind, it means God is your constant consideration. That is when the blessings you receive are the blessings from above. Genesis 1:26. And God said, let us make man, how? In our, meaning everything mankind did should have reflected the glory of God. Let me see how bold you are. Some of you volunteer. Tell me why you chose what you chose. What's your name?
I'm
Jane. Who?
Jane.
Jana. Spell it for me.
It's Jane.
Jane. J-A-N-E. Where are you from, Jane?
From Congo.
Congo. All right. Why did you, what are you studying?
I'm studying.
Why?
No,
no, no, you're saying that now because of what I said. What was your original reason, Jane? Don't lie, God is listening. Why did you choose it?
Yeah, I chose
first.
First, I want to become a doctor.
Why?
So that I can help people.
Do atheists help people? Yes. What's the difference between you and an atheist? Yes, if you said it, drug lords build houses for the people who live in their community. What's the difference in your motivation? What were you thinking of God, Jane? That's my direct question to you. Were you thinking of, here's how I'll glorify God and people will come to know God? Do you realize as a doctor, if you make someone healthy, the healthier a person is, the more effectively the person can sin? Do you realize that? So you may be hurting the kingdom of God by making people healthy. God has no interest in healthy sinners. He wants healthy saints. So you were not thinking of God. Are you with me, Jane? All right, I'll leave you alone so you can repent. Somebody else. Yes, you're laughing at Jane. What's your name?
Goldie.
Hello, Goldie. How are you? Where are you from?
Philippines.
Yeah, you're from all over the Philippines. Okay. What were you thinking of, Goldie, when you chose?
English.
Oh, that's what I did in college, undergraduate level. I like you, Goldie. Mm-hmm. Now, what were you thinking of? Tell the truth.
Yes, I will tell the truth. This is the truth. Mm-hmm. I took English because it's one of the easiest way to go out to a country where I can have a work that will give me a lot of money.
In other words, your speech means you were not thinking of God.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for your honesty and your bright smile. But that smile won't save you until God becomes first. Are you following me? All right. So you need to repent like James, Sister Goldie. Okay, all right. Yes, you. What's your name? Angel is a nice name. Where are your wings? Okay, Sister Angel. What are you studying? Who? Why? Tell the truth, Angel. Angels don't lie. Why? Your parents wanted you. Oh, so your parents are God. I didn't know that. Okay. Well, God bless your parents. But the Bible says, whether therefore ye eat or drink, or whatsoever ye do, Sister Angel, finish the verse. Yes. Now, God bless all parents, but Jesus looked in the eyes of his earthly parents in Luke 2:49, and he said, how is it ye sought me, wist ye not, who can finish the verse, that I must be about my Father's business? Listen to me, understand this. The more in tune you are with God's will, the more of a blessing you are to your parents.
I did fall to you sleeping with your eyes open. Let me try that again. The more a man or a woman follows God's will, the more a man or a woman thinks with a heavenly mind, the more that person is a blessing to the earth. Mm-hmm. All right, angels, so you have to repent. You have to find a reason that glorifies God. What do you say? You're studying engineering? Okay. Why did you choose what you chose? You engineer. All right. Why? What's your name?
AJ.
AJ, yes, AJ. Why did you choose it? Tell the truth. Always tell the truth on Mondays. Why did you choose it?
I just like engineering.
You just like engineering.
Yes.
And all sinners like sin. You see, AJ, that's the wrong reason. Now, God is an engineer. Don't misunderstand me. God is an English specialist. God is an engineer. God is an accountant. God is in nursing, whatever, biologist. But your reason must be that, how will I make God look good? Daniel was a politician. He made God look good. Luke was a doctor. He made God look good. That's the question. Not how will I make my parents look good because one of their children is a doctor. How will my choice make God look good? Listen to me, my young friends. When you think like that, your life has very few regrets. If any, your life will have challenges, but God will work you through the challenges. How will this make God look good? Because Romans 2:24 says, the name of God is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you, meaning the children of God. Somebody else. My good brother, what are you studying? Yes.
Counting.
Tell me your name again. Your name?
Junior.
Junior. And where are you from?
Congo.
Congo is a good place. Now, why did you study accounting? Why are you studying accounting, Junior? Were you thinking of God, yes or no?
No.
All right, we want this fellowship you, but you need to repent. I'm very serious. Okay, let me come over. Yes, you. What do you say? You're hoping I won't call you. What's your name? That's your name?
No.
Okay, what's your name? Who?
Alberta.
Alberta is a good name. That's a province in Canada. Okay. What are you studying, engineering? Are you a Christian?
Yes.
Okay, why did you choose engineering? The truth.
Honestly.
You don't know. God bless you for not knowing. Okay. Let me come at it differently. Who among you were thinking of God? Now, this is raw honesty. You were thinking of God when you made your choice. Raise your hand.